All right. Of course, we will talk about the importance of local government units during a time like this. But let's talk about first, just to update, are you mobilizing anything right now for Typhoon Odette?
Yes, like every other LGU, we're mobilizing. I'm still thinking like a governor. I just came back from Ilocos Norte. One of the things we did in Yolanda was the electric co-ops of Northern Luzon went down and electrified much of Tacloban as well as the nearby towns. I think this can be done very quickly together with power barges and other facilities that our power producers have. And I think this is what we can do. We can also call on a lot of the NGOs like Tsuchi of Taiwan that really did a huge superhuman job in Tacloban. Sana gawin natin to. But in the meantime, the LGUs have really learned a lot and I applaud them after Yolanda. Kung tutuusin ang baba-baba ng death count, talaga naman yung hindi nga zero casualty rate. But given the strength of the storm, it is a very, very low count and that's because of the preparedness and the evacuation done by the LGUs. We've learned from Yolanda after all.
Okay, Senator, that's quite interesting because you do have some observers saying LGUs could have done better. I wanted to ask you your assessment on that. Right now, there's 375 people dead, areas without water, food. Some of them do not have prepositioned goods. How would you assess overall how LGUs actually prepared for the storm?
I think to the best of their ability, these are after all, fourth, fifth, sixth class municipalities in Northern Mindanao. You're talking about Vismin, Southern Leyte, that it's so good, Maasin. This is right in my neighborhood. And you know, really the capacity of LGUs is very, very low. So we were hoping that the Mandanas ruling would resolve this. And truly at the end of the day, no matter how personal and how institutionalized President Duterte makes these rescue efforts. The reality is the first responders at every calamity are the LGUs kasi they're the ones there. Sila yung in situ, sila yung tatakbuhan ng tao, sila rin talaga ang inaasahan. But at the end of the day, how much money does an LGU have at the sixth class level to preposition medicine, to preposition generators, to put water potability facilities and so on? It's a tough, tough call.
Okay, 2022 would have made a difference for the LGUs with the Mandanas ruling, but it doesn't look like the LGUs will completely benefit. What are your concerns, Senator, with the Mandanas ruling implementation?
Yes, that's correct. I was one of the petitioners there, so I'm really part and parcel of the story. Ramdam na ramdam ko parin yung pagiging governor, not LGU. And the truth of the matter is, first, I'm very, very perplexed. Wala bang Viber group ang ating cabinet? Kasi we hear the president talk about federalism and decentralizing Imperial Manila. And yet the economic managers have fought the Mandanas ruling every step of the way, postponing it in the first place. And then secondly, now we are excluding 431 billion from what would have been a windfall for the LGUs. We were expecting an increase in the national tax share of up to 55% for every LGU. And that would have made a huge difference, a massive difference in the small municipalities that were hit by Odette. Sana nakatulong yan at nakapaglagay sila ng mga food packs. They could have put engineering equipment. They could have put better evacuation facilities that had water and electricity. But no, wala pang pera eh. Talagang napakasakit.
Oh, but are you saying, technically what you're saying is the Department of Finance excluded more than 431 billion pesos that belongs to the LGU and they centralized it back to the National Treasury? Can they do that, Senator?
Well, I think what has happened, which which we felt every step of the way, was that while it was pending in the Supreme Court, there were numerous reconsiderations, pabalik-balik yan, and we kept winning. The LGUs kept winning. Ang problema ngayon is that once the judgment came out, the implementation, tinawaran nila, they pushed it back and pushed it back, and it reached 2022, basically kicking the can down the road to the next administration, as it were, and then started excluding things like the sports equipment, hindi daw kasali yan sa customs, hindi daw kasali yung barn, hindi daw kasali. Because the Constitution is very clear-cut, all income, meaning hindi lang BIR, kundi customs, documentary and stamp tax, excise taxes, all these collections are part of the big pie na hati-hati lahat ng LGU at ng national government. So this is our problem. And maliban pa dun, aside from the postponement, aside from the exclusions, yung ikatlo pa doon, they're devolving very, very critical services such as health. They're saying that from 2022 to 2025, kanya-kanya na yung mga small rural and provincial hospitals, which, as we already know, are in miserable state. And if you turn them over to very poor and hamstrung LGUs that have had 2 years of COVID, eh, hindi kakayanin talaga.
Oh, but Senator, is the Department of Finance frankly violating the law?
Well, I have a sense that the president hopefully will come back to this and revisit the executive order. And there will be more consultations with the LGUs. I'm particularly worried about the small, rural, remote LGUs. Kung tutuusin, NCR, the Cebu provinces, even Davao, kaya nila, they're self-sufficient. And they should look at it as the first step toward federalism, which the president has been espousing from the very, very beginning. I think the other thing that we should consider in addition to the LGU is the failure to pass the bills, and dami-daming bills, saying that there should be a special agency called the Department of Disaster Resilience.
Yes.
And antagal na niyan eh. That's been going on. That's being kicked back and forth many times. In the United States, we hear of FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management Agency. Sana may ganon. Because the NDRRMC, to the best of their ability, are coping. But the reality is, there's that toxic word of coordination. Kami sa gobyerno, pag narinig yung coordination, nako, wala yan. Turuan niya ng turuan. So, kawawang NDRMC because that's all they can do. Hila-hila dito, tulong-tulong sa department, umaasa sila sa iba't ibang sekretary na magko-comply at magmamadali. But in the middle, they have very, very little to give.
Oh, so Senator, that's interesting because the Department for Migrant Workers already passed on third and final reading in the Senate. What happened to the Department of Disaster Resiliency? Wasn't this a priority of the administration?
Yes, I think it was a priority, but like everything else, a lot of these initiatives fell by the wayside because of COVID. Wala talagang pera. Ako, Ilocano style, syempre, no? Dakila eh. Dakilang na nagtitipid. Eh, ayoko ng department kagad. So I was thinking, and the bill I filed was an authority, some kind of smaller agency. Because kung department yan, sa limang undersecretary pa lang, sa sahod pa lang yan, ubus na yung budget. Napakalaki noon. So I wanted it to start on a smaller scale. So that we could see how effective it was, at the same time giving it more than coordination powers because we saw that failure in Tacloban.
Oh, but after Typhoon Odette, I want to ask you, have you changed your mind? Do you now believe there should be a department?
Well, I've been consistent all along. The fact that you declare a department doesn't overnight solve the problem. As we've seen, you know, we've had departments like DICT. Eh, hindi naman gumaganda yung internet. Umaasa pa rin tayo sa ating mga private companies that they will really do the last mile and connect up to the mountains and the islands. But the reality is DICT is incapable because it lacks budget, it needs technology. technological power, it doesn't have the trained staff and personnel. For all these reasons, we've ended up with ghost departments, like DICT, to my mind, the housing or human settlements. Eh, wala namang budget, umaasa rin sa NHA, umaasa sa pag-ibig, sa kung ano-ano pang ahensya dyan. So I think just putting up a department and then not endowing it completely with budget, not having the trained, skilled sets that are required, does not solve the problem. So maybe we can start muna with a smaller authority, for example, and that would not merely coordinate, but actually lead the charge against these dreadful calamities that, as we know, will increase with climate change.
Okay, now very quickly, Senator, with 431 billion pesos scrapped out of LGUs for 2022, that's actually meant for the LGUs based on the Mandanas ruling, how could this have helped, for example, Siargao, Dinagat Islands, Surigao, I think Surigao del Norte,
these right.
municipalities that have been hit, Senator, areas in Palawan with Typhoon Odette in terms of rehab?
I mean, in terms even of connectivity, wala man lang silang satellite phone. Because you know, these small provinces, at some point, were given satellite phones like us in Ilocos, but we barely turn them on simply because they're charged in dollars. They're hugely expensive to operate. We never turn them on. We're so nervous. And that's the situation with them. They don't even have satellite phones. We don't even know what's happening. In Sogod, up to now, yung mga kamag-anak ko, hindi ko pa natatawag. My son, Borgie, who has a shop in Siargao, is still looking for his employees, his staff, and his friends. And we simply can't find them. So yung pinaka-basic, the satellite, no, the connectivity, at least you can communicate, tell us what's happening to you. Then secondly, of course, water to save human life. You really need the water to be going. And there's simply no potable water, even in the center of Cebu City. This is disgraceful. And then power, of course, there's no electricity. And it goes on and on and on. If the LGUs had been capacitated and really funded properly, I think they could have done a better job. Not that I'm faulting them, because I think they've done an absolutely heroic feat by keeping the casualties down, pero it could have been better.
Okay. Now, Senator, may mapagkukunan pa ba sa budget for rehabilitation of areas in Visayas? The president did promise 2 billion, I think, to Bohol, if I'm correct. No, I could be corrected on this, but there have been so many areas that need to be rehabilitated.
Yes, that's correct. And so many of these funds have already been utilized for COVID. We've had a really tough time with the 2022 budget because the assumption of DBM is magically COVID would have disappeared by 2022. To be fair, lahat tayo, akala natin, pag na-vaccinate, okay na. Hindi naman natin alam magkakaroon ng Delta, magkakaroon pa pala ng Omicron, napakahirap naman pala. As a result, the 2022 budget has been a real struggle between the economy and its requirements for stimuli, as well as the health considerations. Kasi walang budget para dun sa mga variant, para sa booster, para sa mga bata na kailangan pala i-boost din. All these things. Right now, ang pagkaalam ko, DSWD, wala ng contingency, wala ng calamity fund yan. Yung DA, agriculture, wala na rin yan. DepEd, siguro may konting natitira. Public Works, baka may natitira pa. Yung DOH, mukhang wipe out na. Baka DND, may konti pa. These are the contingency quick response funds that are embedded in our budget that never seem to be enough for these dreadful calamities. So perhaps we need to jump from disaster response and transit into resiliency, to build resilient cities and coastal towns.
And how would we do that, Senator? How would we do that considering the limitations of the budget? How would you approach that?
Well, unang-una, it's very, very clear. You know, world-class beaches in Brazil, for example, are 200 meters away from the waterline. Tayo mga Pilipino, gusto natin, pagbukas ng pinto, we're in the water. And you can't build that closely. We learned that already from Yolanda. We see it again in Siargao. It's the same story. We're building too close to the ocean. We will never win against Mother Ocean.
No, this is very interesting that you pointed that out, specifically for Siargao, because all the resorts in front of the beach have been wiped out. Should there be a new set of rules, considering it's been quite clear what the DENR has said already?
Yes, I think the rules are there, if truth be told, Karen, and our viewers know that. Where we fail, I think we should be celebrated for our good intentions. But where we fail is in the implementation. We simply don't enforce this. And I think there has to be a great deal of political will, of responsibility among our LGUs. And perhaps the following election is a good chance. You get a fresh mandate, you do what needs to be done.
Mm-mm. Okay, last on the Mandanas ruling, given that you have pointed this out, does this mean that you'd want, I'm curious, do you still have the time, for example, to call on the Department of Finance? Will there be a Senate hearing? Will they be questioned why they excluded 431 billion pesos? That should have gone to the LGUs directly. I mean, it won't seem that easy with Secretary Dominguez.
Yes, I think at this point, the ball is in the DBM's court. It's the Department of Budget and Management that is culling the guidelines for the implementation of the Mandanas ruling. I hope that they consult the LGUs more comprehensively, more thoroughly, more patiently, and understand that at the end of the day, there are LGUs like Makati and Quezon City that for them, the national tax allotment, the share, is not that big. Their income is large enough. But then there are the small municipalities, the provinces like Surigao del Norte, Surigao del Sur, Agusan, and Southern Leyte that cannot bear the brunt of typhoons and calamities of this scale.
Okay,